Good evening, everyone. My name is Brent Baldwin, and I'm the Artistic Director of Panoramic Voices. I'd like to welcome you here to another virtual installment. Our 2021 season has been all virtual, so much like most of the performing arts groups out there. This is the way we keep the music alive, and these productions are free to the public. They're a free musical offering. Of course, we're gonna, in the chat and in the comments, we're gonna include a donation link. If you are inspired by what you hear here tonight, and I think you will be, you are more than welcome to help us, help support us, continue to create these virtual productions all the way through until the time when we get back to doing in-person performances, even though we fully intend to keep on doing this virtual thing. We've sort of fallen in love with it. It's been the only thing we could fall in love with during this pandemic. So, but we've just been really trying to find the creative ways of art making. So speaking of creative art making, tonight we are going to feature two of my very favorite Austin artists. We have Joseph Choi, an amazing pianist, and of course the one and only amazing soprano, Natalie Joy. We're gonna get the music rolling here in a couple of seconds, but I just wanted to tell you about a couple of pieces that we have coming up. I also wanted to let you know that the artists themselves are gonna be tuning in and talking a bit about the pieces. So get excited about that. So first up, we are going to hear in this first set of three pieces, we're going to hear a beautiful piece called Joy by Ricky Yin Gordon and Je Te Veux by Erik Satie. Those will be sung by Natalie Joy, accompanied by Joseph. But to kick things off, let's go ahead and put the spotlight on Joseph Choi. He's going to play the incredible Reflet dans l'eau by Claude Debussy. So please sit back, enjoy, and thank you so much for being here tonight. Thank you. Well, welcome back, everybody. Wow, some amazing music there. And speaking of amazing, I'd like to introduce the two featured artists tonight. We have with us, joining us live, we've got Natalie Joy, we've got Joseph Choi. Welcome, y'all. I know that y'all are keeping busy. Joseph, you're teaching Concordia and doing probably 100 million other things. And Natalie, I know you've been keeping busy and teaching at the Armstrong Community Music School. So I just want to thank you so much for taking time out of your extremely busy schedules to pop in and just talk some music tonight. We'll get back to listening to some music, but I just wanted to, you know, get a little talk going here. Joseph, you started off the program, so I just kind of have to ask, as somebody who dabbles in Debussy at the piano, I like to think that I play it and then I hear, you know, actual pianists like you play something way harder than I typically play on a daily basis. So what does it, you know, musician to musician, but to everybody tuning in, you know, what's your process in taking on a piece like that Debussy?
Yeah, well, first off, I would love to hear you play Debussy. I think that would be a lot of fun. in terms of learning Debussy, you know, something about the impressionistic language just sits well with me. You know, it feels natural. It feels like I'm sort of speaking English. Actually, I probably speak impressionistic piano better than I do English. It's just, yeah, I don't know what it is. It feels good. Yeah. And in terms of learning, you know, I think a lot of images, of colors, of course, structure and theory helps. I thank my music degrees and my teachers for being super patient with me and graduating me. Debussy feels good. And never felt like a struggle to learn, per se.
Wow. Well, I wish I could say the same, but I'm glad there are beautiful humans like you in the universe who can make those fingers fly a little bit better. I'm a little more comfortable on the guitar, but man, I just, I love the piano. I love Debussy on the piano in particular. So thank you so much for that. And Natalie, so amazing to see you. It's been a while since the real life, you know, I'll take Natalie on the screen. Over no Natalie at all. So thank you so much for being here. Eric Satie, I love, you know, two French composers I love. Debussy is amazing. And then Satie is such an oddball. You know, you've got the Vexations piece that goes on for hours and hours and hours and just so many incredibly weird descriptors that go often with his pieces. Tell us a little bit about that piece. What was it we were listening into?
Well, this is actually one of his cabaret songs. He has quite a few cabaret songs that he wrote, I think, in the around the middle of his career, as we all do, you know, to make some money, okay, to live, to eat, to have shelter and be clothed. And I relate. I think we can relate. And I think it's so interesting that later in his life, he completely rejected all of these cabaret songs, but they're so popular. I heard Je te veux instrumentally in the background of a cat food commercial. It's popular.
That's very amazing.
Very popular. But he completely rejected it. He said they were vile. They were not naturally what he would do. They're not of his style. You know, that's just something I did for income. But man, I'm glad he did them. He wrote another cabaret song called The Diva of the Empire, La Diva de l'Empire. And it's just so much fun to sing. It's very dramatic and divalicious. And this one was so much fun to sing, je te veux, meaning I want you. Just over and over and over saying, I want you. And that was so much fun to sing.
Oh man, I could tell. I mean, I was there at the this event. You know, of course, we are taking all the precautions and keeping our performers from getting other performers sick. This happened originally in January of 2020. I had the honor of course of being there, and I could just tell that you were enjoying singing that, and Joseph, of course, playing the pants off it. So thank you for that background. I knew a little bit about the cabaret thing. I'm learning the sort of disavowal story of it tonight, or I might have learned that in some graduate music history class way back when, and you know, life happens. Natalie, I wonder if we've got a couple pieces coming up. Would you be so kind as to let us know what's on the horizon here for the people at home?
Yes. Next up, and this is not the right order that I'm going to say them in, but is Creole Girl, written by Leslie Adams. He is a Black American composer, has written operas, art songs, and instrumental pieces and orchestral pieces. He's quite prolific. He is currently living, so please go look him up. Google Leslie A. Adams. Oh, excuse me, Leslie H. Adams. He's got quite the repertoire list, and the music is absolutely stunning, as you will hear in this next segment. And then, I don't know if it's before or...
we'll do some Brahms before, but...
We'll do Brahms
this
before.
This is great.
And it's Kommt der Mannschmal from Zigeunerlieder. And it's just such a stunning piece. It's one of my favorite pieces on the program. These two pieces are actually two of my favorite pieces on this program. And I'm very excited for all of you to hear it.
Oh, me too. Well, here's some Brahms and some Adams, and let's just, we'll be quiet now. We'll let some music happen. Well, welcome back, everybody. And I love me some Brahms any day of the week, but Leslie Adams, like what a fantastic composer. Natalie, I'm kind of speechless. I love that piece so much. You want to talk a little bit more about that?
Absolutely. I love it too. It's actually one part of a song cycle called Night Songs. It's the end song. And it's just so stunningly beautiful. There's the gorgeous juxtaposition of the upbeat, up-tempo, little Spanish-flavored sections, and then we come to this deeply melancholy section almost at the end, and then we switch it back to that fun danced lilt that's going on. And it's very indicative of the subtext of the text, the meaning of the text. It just is such a beautiful setting of this text, of this poem.
Oh, man.
And I think coming up next from me, my offerings will be a Strauss piece by Richard Strauss, Wie gibst du mit mich Frieden, from the opera Der Liebe der Danae, which is The Love of Danae, and it is the story from the Midas myth, which we'll talk about a little later. And then I will also sing another piece by a Black composer, English this time, of the diaspora, from Samuel Coleridge Taylor, You Lay So Still in the Sunshine.
Oh, beautiful. Thank you for that. Coleridge Taylor is one of my favorites. Just so beautiful. I can't wait for us to share that with everybody. But before those two pieces coming up, we've got another feature for Joseph Choi. This time we're going to hear some Chopin. Tell us just a little bit about this, Joseph, if you wouldn't mind.
Yeah, Chopin's infamous ballade in G minor. I think once you hear sort of the opening arpeggio, it'll be like instantly recognizable. About this piece, Chopin obviously composed it. He actually loved this piece, unlike the Fantasy Impromptu. Schumann also was a good friend of Chopin. When he received the score, he liked the piece. And as a performer in the 21st century, and hopefully as listeners in the 21st century, you also like this piece. It's so popular, actually, that films sort of like the piece that Natalie sung beautifully, the Satie piece. Oh, this ballade is featured in films such as the Impromptu with Hugh Grant as Chopin. I think more recently, maybe in the past decade or so, maybe two decades, we have Adrian Brody, and playing this ballade in The Pianist, that famous scene, that's pretty cool. But by far my favorite has to be the heart-wrenching Japanese anime, Your Lie in April. Yeah, a little bit. I just revealed a little bit of myself there. I do like anime. From all the research that I've done on this piece and of Chopin, really not much needs to be said about Chopin's sort of epic poem. But I think the scholar Tomaszewski says it best. He says, the language of Chopin's music is the language of algebra, so to speak, and not of arithmetic. It doesn't need any concrete values to be set beneath it. It inhabits the realm of feelings and moods, experiences and passions that are unalloyed, not embroiled in detail and anecdote.
Wow. Oh, beautifully said. Thank you. And we'll be talking some other time, perhaps over beer when everybody's gotten their Fauci ouchie. But yeah, we'll talk more anime because I didn't know that. And now I know something and where I want to dig a little bit more into that another time. But the question remains, was this very beloved Chopin piece ever featured in a cat food commercial? That's the mystery that we'll pose to our listeners. Go Google. And yeah, let's hear some more music. Thank you all so very much.
Thank you.
Well, welcome back, everybody. Wow, Chopin, Strauss, Coleridge Taylor, right in a row. Natalie, you know, singing the pants off is evidently my term for the evening, or playing one's pants off. I mean, just amazing music, and like, I'd love to know a little bit more about. That was our biggest music segment we've got tonight. Like, talk to us a little bit about, I mean, Coleridge Taylor is one of my favorite composers, and Strauss, of course, is hardly a slouch. I'd love to hear anything you have to say about, you know, the backgrounds of those pieces, the preparation that you have, an artist like you has to go through. Just lay it on us.
So, You Lay So Still in the Sunshine is my absolute favorite piece on this program. It's my absolute favorite piece in general. I don't know what it is about it when I heard it, but it just took me on a journey. And the poetry is so, so visceral. It's very, it really paints a picture in one's mind of the setting that it's setting out, right? For me, I always imagine you're in like a garden or in the middle of a forest, right? In the clearing of a forest or something. Somewhere out in beautiful nature, maybe the wildflowers that have sprouted up everywhere, which are so gorgeous. You know, and all of these things are happening, and it's just, if relaxation and self-care was a song, it's this song. And I absolutely love this piece. I will never not sing this piece. For the Strauss, okay, let me tell you. Oh. This is funny. It's not meant to be funny. It's just funny to me. First of all, the story goes, you know, this beautiful princess, Danai, she's engaged to marry some rich king, man, prince person. And typical opera story, girl meets boy, girl falls in love with boy, girl is engaged to a rich person who is actually boy she fell in love with in disguise, but girl doesn't know that. Hijinks ensue, and then no one ends up together, and everyone is sad at the end. Typical opera story. The boy she's in love with is King Midas. Remember the golden hand myth story? It's that story, and he's turning everything into gold, but not her heart, okay? And what's really funny about this piece is that when I was learning it, at the end. No, that's not right. Well, I was learning it with one of my teachers who's had a great career in Germany in her time and is very fluent in German. And I brought her this piece and I had such a hard time translating it. Now, I don't speak German, but I am able to translate and do all of that good singer stuff. I brought her the piece and I was like, can you check this for me? What's going on here? And she said, well, this is written in Hochdeutsch, High German, a very old way of speaking. And I don't even know what it says. It's that old. So my translation didn't make sense. The song didn't make sense to me. Whatever translation in the program, it doesn't make sense. It probably doesn't make sense. So I had to kind of piece it together with what I knew of the story, because this show is not done very often. It's one of the lesser known Strauss pieces. Usually we have, you know, Ariadne off Naxos and things like that. That's what's really done in the houses. But people aren't really doing Der Liebe der Danai. And there's a reason for that. But it's a gorgeous, gorgeous score. The story doesn't super make sense, but it's opera, so nobody cares. It's a gorgeous score, gorgeous singing opportunities involved, and it's worth singing, even though it doesn't make sense.
Well, I'm so glad that we had the opportunity to share that with everybody, because, oh my gosh, what a gorgeous piece. And yeah, this is an opera I have not seen. And I guess it makes sense that that opportunity hasn't arisen yet, but I'll keep my eyes peeled in case anybody gets brave enough to stage it. I'll know it might be my only chance. Wow. So we've only got a little bit more music here tonight, and we've got a couple of pieces coming up. Charles Lloyd Jr., Margaret Bonds, who's was a regular collaborator with Langston Hughes, and Natalie. This might be. I'd just be curious to know, if you can give us a little bit of background, what it is we're listening to, what we should be listening for. Joseph, I might query you on, I don't know, is this really hard? It sounds really hard. What, you make it sound easy, but man, it's hard.
Well, it's easy to play when you have a good singer, you're supporting. And so it never felt difficult, to be completely honest. Yeah.
Wow. Well, that, and a beautiful compliment, and rightly so, to Natalie. I'm guessing, this is when you pair an amazing pianist with an amazing vocalist, as we did on this program. I think that's probably true for any instrumentalist or vocalist. If you're paired with somebody who just is not only fluent in their technique, but fluent in the passion of creating the music, those things do become easier, even really difficult music like Strauss. And so thank you for that insight. And that was a really beautiful sentiment. Natalie, tell us a bit about these last couple of pieces, if you would, please.
Right. So Compensation, which in this, what you're about to hear, is set by Charles Lloyd Jr., another Black composer. This is a poem by Paul Laurence Dunbar, who was really a really prolific poet during the Harlem Renaissance. And what's very interesting about this particular setting is that Charles Lloyd Jr. only sets the first half of this poem. Most other settings, Margaret Bonds included, she also set this poetry at some point in her career. Most other settings is the full poem, and that completely changes the vibe of the song. As the first half of the poem is very reverent, thanking God for this gift of song and feeling very purposeful about what you have to do with this gift and why you have this gift. The second part of the song talks about using the gift vainly, misusing the gift, not living up to your potential or walking in alignment with your purpose and the consequences of that. So I find it very interesting that Charles Lloyd Jr. decided to just use the first half of the piece. I don't know, because I don't know him personally or anyone from his estate. But what I can speculate, and what I resonated with, was perhaps this just hit him pretty deeply. This little tiny 1 minute song, it's such a short, it's very short, it's succinct, but it gets across what it's trying to get across. And it's just beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful. I'm so thankful that this song exists. Minstrel Man by Margaret Bonds. Such a gorgeous song. Very widely sung. And I love hearing people singing this song. To me, it reminds me of when W.E.B. Du Bois and I think I may be attributing this. No, it wasn't W.E.B. Du Bois who said this. It was James Baldwin, excuse me. When James Baldwin talked about having a double consciousness. No, they both talked about this concept, but named it two different things. That's why they're both coming up in my brain. But basically, it's having your true self, who you are as a person, and then how America sees you as a Black person. And this song, Minstrel Man, is in alignment with that concept of double consciousness, which is the same in the same line as code switching, which is in the same line as, you know, a lot of the things James Baldwin talked about and wrote about. And I love this song. It's a great introspective look into this experience, and I'm very glad to share it with all of you.
Well, thank you so much for giving us that background. Let's go ahead and hear these two beautiful pieces back to back. Well, welcome back, everybody. We have reached the end of our program, and I just want to thank you so very much for tuning in and listening to what Panoramic Voices is broadcasting. We are continually creating new content, and we're going to be streaming a number of events coming up in the coming months. A couple of four examples, we're going to be we've been seeing Natalie Joy here all night long. We're going to be featuring the Foray Requiem coming up in mid-May. And if you've enjoyed listening and watching Natalie weave her sonic magic here tonight, she's also the featured soprano in that Foray Requiem. So be sure to tune back in. We've got some other things coming up. We've got a really neat collaboration happening with the dance collective Arcos on some new premiere work that we'll be putting together. We're doing some other new music with the new music collective Tetractus, and just a whole bunch of other things. And if you want to keep up with all of this, I would love to just throw this pitch at you that you can go to our YouTube channel and you can subscribe. And that's where the a lot of the videos that we're just kind of regularly uploading will appear, and you can see what we've done and see what we have coming up. Yeah, definitely follow us on Facebook. We'll be sure to be putting posts out regularly just to let people know what's coming up. You can go to our website at panoramicvoices.org and sign up for the email list. That's a great way to keep up with what it is we're doing. And so on. If you have enjoyed the music here tonight, I just like to remind you that we've got our donation link there. That's going to help us, if you're so moved, to continue to create new content to share with you all here in the virtual realm. And if you are a singer or if you know singers, please pass along the word that you can go to our website and find out about a whole slew of singer opportunities where you can become a part of Panoramic Voices. So just putting that little bug out there. And I would just love to thank, there's so many people to thank when we do productions like this, but I would definitely love to thank Kevin Chin at North Shore Media Productions, who's kind of been doing the when we go live and when we don't go live. And that is a tricky chore. We're really thankful to Kevin for his amazing work. Very thankful to the Panoramic Voices production team and board for just getting all this stuff working and together. And I definitely love to thank all of you at home who are tuning in. And last but not least, I would just love to thank one more time these two beautiful artists who have shared their music and their stories and their and just so many beautiful things here tonight. So Natalie, Joseph, thank you so very much for being here. It's been such a treat. So without further ado, we will see you in our next virtual production. And until then, we'll wish you a beautiful night. And you all stay safe out there. All right, take care. Bye-bye. Thanks, everyone.